Lockheed AC-130. The Lockheed AC-130 gunship is a heavily armed, long-endurance ground attack variant of the C-130 Hercules transport fixed-wing aircraft. It carries a wide array of anti-ground-oriented weapons that are integrated with sophisticated sensors, navigation, and fire control systems. Unlike other military fixed-wing aircraft, the AC-130 relies on visual targeting. Because its large profile and low operating altitudes, around 7,000 feet, make it an easy target, it usually flies close air support missions at night. The airframe is manufactured by Lockheed Martin, while Boeing is responsible for the conversion into a gunship and for aircraft support. Developed during the Vietnam War as Project Gunship 2, the AC-130 replaced the Douglas AC-47 Spooky, or Gunship I. The sole operator is the United States Air Force, which uses the AC-130U Spooky and AC-130W Stinger II variants for close air support, air interdiction, and force protection, with the AC-130J Ghost Rider in development. Close air support roles include supporting ground troops, escorting convoys, and urban operations. Air interdiction missions are conducted against planned targets and targets off opportunity. Force protection missions include defending air bases and other facilities. AC-130Js are based at Hurlburt Field, Florida, while AC-130Ws are based at Cannon AFB, New Mexico. Gunships can be deployed worldwide. The squadrons are part of the Air Force Special Operations Command, AFSOC, a component of the United States Special Operations Command, SOCOM. The AC-130 has an unpressurized cabin, with the weaponry mounted to fire from the port side of the fuselage. During an attack, the gunship performs a pylon turn, flying in a large circle around the target, therefore being able to fire at it for far longer than in a conventional strafing attack. The AC-130H Spectre was armed with two M61 Vulcan cannons, one L-60 Bofors 40mm cannon, and one M102 howitzer. After 1994, the cannons were removed. The upgraded AC-130U Spooky has a single GAL-12 equalizer cannon in place of the Spectre's two cannons, an improved fire control system, and increased ammunition capacity. The new AC-130J was based on the MC-130J Commando II Special Operations Tanker. The AC-130W Stinger II is a modified C-130H with upgrades including a precision strike package. During the Vietnam War, the C-130 Hercules was selected to replace the Douglas AC-47 Spooky gunship, Project Gunship I, in order to improve mission endurance and increase the capacity to carry munitions. Capable of flying faster than helicopters and at high altitudes with excellent loiter time, the use of the pylon turn allowed the AC-47 to deliver continuous accurate fire to a single point on the ground. In 1967, JC-130A-54-1626 was selected for conversion into the prototype AC-130A gunship, Project Gunship II. The modifications were done at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base B, the Aeronautical Systems Division. A direct-view night vision telescope was installed in the forward door, an early forward-looking infrared device in the forward part of the left wheel well, and Gatling guns fixed facing down and aft along the left side. The analog fire control computer prototype was handcrafted by RAF Wing Commander Tom Pinkerton at the USAF Avionics Laboratory at Wright-Patterson AFB. Flight testing of the prototype was performed primarily at Eglin Air Force Base, followed by further testing and modifications. By September 1967, the aircraft was certified ready for combat testing and was flown to Nha Trang Air Base, South Vietnam for a 90-day test program. The AC-130 was later supplemented by the AC-119 Shadow, Project Gunship 3, which later proved to be underpowered. Seven more warplanes were converted to the Plain Jane configuration like the AC-130 prototype in 1968, and one aircraft received the Surprise Package refit in 1969. The Surprise Package upgrade included the latest 20mm rotary autocannons and 40mm Bofors cannon but no 7.62mm close support armament. The Surprise Package configuration served as a testbed for the avionics systems and armament for the AC-130E. In 1970, 10 more AC-130s were acquired under the PAVE Pronto project. In the summer of 1971, Surprise Package AC-130s were converted to the PAVE Pronto configuration and assumed the new nickname of Thor. Conversion of C-130s into AC-130s for the PAVE Spectre project followed. Regardless of their project names, the aircraft were more commonly referred to by the squadron's call sign Spectre. In 2007, Air Force Special Operations Command, AFSOC, initiated a program to upgrade the armament of AC-130s. The test program planned for the 25mm Gal-12/U and 40mm Bofors cannon on the AC-130U gunships to be replaced with two 30mm Mk-44 Bushmaster II cannons. In 2007, the Air Force modified four AC-130U gunships as test platforms for its Bushmasters. These were referred to as AC-130U plus 4 or AC-130U plus 4. AFSOC, however, cancelled its plans to install the new cannons on its fleet of AC-130s. It has since removed the guns and reinstalled the original 40mm and 25mm cannons and returned the planes to combat duty. Brigadier General Bradley A. Heitold, AFSOC's Director of Plans, Programs, Requirements, and Assessments, said on August 11, 2008 that the effort was cancelled because of problems with the Bushmaster's accuracy and tests at the altitude we were employing it. There were also schedule considerations that drove the decision, he said. There were also plans to possibly replace the 105mm cannon with a breech-loading 120mm M120 mortar, and to give the AC-130 a standoff capability using either the AGM-114 Hellfire missile, the Advanced Precision Kill Weapon System, based on the Hydra 70 rocket, or the Viper Strike glide bomb. In 2010, the Air Force awarded L-3 Communications a $61 million contract to add precision strike packages to 8 MC-130W Combat Spear Special Mission aircraft to give TAMA gunship-like attack capability. Such equipped MC-130Ws are known as Dragon Spears. Air Force Special Operations Command is arming these aircraft to relieve the high operational demands on AC-130 gunships until new AC-130JS enters service. The MC-130W Dragon Spear was renamed AC-130W Stinger II in 2011. The precision strike packages consist of a 30mm gun and several precision-guided munitions, PGMs. Rails are mounted on the outboard pylon of the wing for four Hellfire missiles, SDBs, or SDB-2s under each. 10 common launch tubes, CLDs, are mounted on the rear ramp to fire Griffin A missiles. Additional missiles are stored in the aircraft that can be reloaded in flight. CLDs are able to fire other small munitions able to fit inside the diameter, long tubes. The Air Force launched an initiative in 2011 to acquire 16 new gunships based on new-built MC-130J Combat Shadow II Special Operations tankers outfitted with a precision strike package to give them an attack capability, requesting $1.6 billion from fiscal years 2011 through 2015. This would increase the size of the gunship fleet to 33 aircraft, a net increase of 8 after the planned retirement of 8 aging AC-130Hs. The first aircraft would be bought in fiscal 2012, followed by two in fiscal 2013, five in fiscal 2014, and the final eight in fiscal 2015. The decision to retain the C-130 came after funding for 16 C-27JS was removed from the fiscal 2010 budget. The AC-130J will follow the path of the Dragon Spear program. On January 9, 2013, the Air Force began converting the first MC-130J Combat Shadow II into an AC-130J Ghost Rider and delivered it to AFSOC on July 29, 2015. The first AC-130J gunships achieved initial operational capability, IOC, on September 30, 2017. The AC-130J has two plan increments. The Block 10 configuration includes an internal 30mm gun, small diameter bombs, and laser-guided missiles launched from the rear cargo door. And Block 20 configuration adds a 105mm cannon, large aircraft infrared countermeasures, wing-mounted Hellfire missiles, and radio frequency countermeasures. The Air Force decided to add a 105mm cannon to the AC-130J in addition to the 30mm cannon and smart bombs, the shells being more accurate and cheaper than dropping SDB-S. AFSOC is interested in adding a directed energy weapon to the AC-130J by 2020. Similar to the previous Advanced Tactical Laser program. It is to produce a beam of up to 120 kilowatts, or potentially even 180 to 200 kilowatts, weigh about, defensively destroy anti-aircraft missiles, and offensively engage communications towers, boats, cars, and aircraft. However, laser armament may only be installed on a few aircraft rather than the entire AC-130J fleet. The laser will be mounted on the side in place of 30mm cannon. Other potential additions include an active denial system to perform airborne crowd control, and small unmanned aerial vehicles from the common launch tubes to provide remote video feed and coordinates to weapons operators through cloud cover. Called the Tactical Offboard Sensor, TOBS, the drones would be expendable and fly along a pre-programmed orbit to verify targets the aircraft can't see itself because of bad weather or standing off from air defenses. IFSOC will initially utilize the Raytheon Coyote small UAV for the TOBS mission, as it is an off-the-shelf design with a one-hour endurance, but plans to fulfill the role with a new drone capable of a four-hour endurance by 2019. The Air Force was also interested in acquiring a glide bomb that can be launched from the common launch tubes capable of hitting ground vehicles traveling as fast as 120 km per hour 70 miles per hour, while above. In June 2016, Dynetics was awarded a contract by SOCOM to integrate its tactical munition onto the AC-130. Designated the GBU-69/B small glide munition. The weapon weighs and is armed with a blast fragmentation warhead that can detonate by direct impact or at a pre-selected height. Despite being smaller, being unpowered allows more volume for its warhead to be heavier than those on the Hellfire and Griffin missiles, and respectively. Guidance is provided by a GPS receiver with ONDI spoofing software and four distributed aperture semi-active laser seeker, DASLs, apertures adapted from the WGU-59/B APCOS for terminal guidance. Approval for fielding occurred in early 2017. Dynetics was awarded a contract to deliver an initial batch of 70 SGMs in June 2017, with plans to buy up to 1,000. The SGM can travel. By 2018, AC-130 gunships will have been providing close air support for special operators for 50 years. Although the aircraft have been kept relevant through constant upgrades to their weaponry, sensor packages, and countermeasures, they are not expected to be survivable in future non-permissive environments due to their high signatures and low airspeeds. Military analysts, such as the Center for Strategic and Budgetary Assessments, have suggested that IFSOC invest in more advanced technologies to fill the role to operate in future contested combat zones, including a mix of low-cost disposable unmanned and stealthy strike aircraft. The AC-130 is a heavily armed long-endurance aircraft carrying an array of anti-ground-oriented weapons that are integrated with sophisticated sensors, navigation, and fire control systems. It is capable of delivering precision firepower or area saturation fire over a target area over a long period of time, at night or in adverse weather. The sensor suite consists of a television sensor, infrared sensor, and radar. These sensors allow the gunship to visually or electronically identify friendly ground forces and targets in most weather conditions. The AC-130U is equipped with the IN/APQ-180, a synthetic aperture radar for long-range target detection and identification. The gunship's navigational devices include inertial navigation systems and a global positioning system. The AC-130U employs technologies developed in the 1990s which allow it to attack two targets simultaneously. It has twice the munitions capacity of the AC-130H. Although the AC-130U conducts some operations in daylight, most of its combat missions are conducted at night. The AC-130H's unit cost is $132.4 million, and the AC-130U's cost is $190 million, fiscal 2001 dollars. During the Vietnam War era, the various AC-130 versions following the PAVE Prado modifications were equipped with a magnetic anomaly detector system called Black Crow designated IN/AST-5, a highly sensitive passive device with a phased array antenna located in the left front nose radome that could pick up localized deviations in the Earth's magnetic field normally used to detect submerged submarines. The Black Crow system was slaved into the targeting computers of the AC-130A/E/H, enabling the detection of unshielded ignition coils of North Vietnamese trucks hidden under dense jungle foliage along the Ho Chi Minh Trail. It could also detect handheld transmitter signals of air controllers on the ground to identify and locate targets. The PGM-38/U enhanced 25mm high explosive incendiary round was created to expand the AC-130U gunship's mission and standoff range and survivability for its 25mm GA-12/U gun. This round is a combination of the existing PGU-25 Hayana M758 fuse designated as FMU-151/B to meet the MIL STD-1316. The FMU-151 has an improved arming delay with multi-sensitive range. The AC-130 gunship first arrived in South Vietnam on September 21, 1967 under the Gunship 2 program and began combat operations over Laos and South Vietnam that year. In June 1968, AC-130s were deployed to Tan Son Nhut Ab near Saigon for support against the Tet Offensive. By October 30, 1968, enough AC-130 Gunship 2s arrived to form a squadron, the 16th Special Operations Squadron, SOS, of the 8th Tactical Fighter Wing, TFW, at Ubon Royal Thai Air Force Base, Thailand. It was at this time that the C-130A gunship was designated the AC-130A. On August 18, 1968, an AC-130 gunship flying an armed reconnaissance mission in Vietnam's III Corps was diverted to support the KADAM Special Forces Camp. The ground commander quickly assessed the accurate fire and capabilities of this weapon system and called for fire on his own perimeter when the Viet Cong attempted to bridge Thay Wire on the west side of his position. By December 1968, most AC-130s flew under F-4 Phantom II escort to protect the gunship against heavy and concentrated AAA fire from the 497th Tactical Fighter Squadron, normally three Phantoms per gunship. On May 24, 1969, the first Spectre gunship was lost to enemy fire. In late 1969, under codename Surprise Package, 5620490 arrived with solid-state laser-illuminated low-light level TV with a companion YAG laser designator, an improved forward-looking infrared, FLIR, sensor, video recording for TV and FLIR, an inertial navigation system, and a prototype digital fire control computer. The remaining AC-130s were refitted with upgraded similar equipment in the summer of 1970, and then redeployed to Ubon Ratchathai. On October 25, 1971, the first Cadillac gunship, the AC-130E, arrived in Vietnam. On February 17, 1972, the first 105mm cannon arrived for service with Spectre and was installed on gunship 570. It was used from mid-February until the aircraft received battle damage to its right flap. The cannon was switched to gunship 571 and was used until 30 March when the aircraft was shot down. On January 28, 1973, the Vietnam Peace Accord went into effect, marking the end of Spectre operations in Vietnam. Spectre was still needed and active in the region, supporting operations in Laos and Cambodia. On February 22, 1973, American offensive operations in Laos ended and the gunships became totally committed to operations in the Cambodian conflict. On April 12, 1975, the Khmer Rouge were threatening the capital of Phnom Penh and AC-130s were called on to help in Operation Eagle Pull, the final evacuation of American and Allied officials from Phnom Penh before it was conquered by the communists. The AC-130 was also over Saigon on April 30, 1975 to protect the final evacuation in Operation Frequent Wind. Spectres were also called in when the SS Mayaguez was seized, on the open sea, by Khmer Rouge soldiers and sailors on May 15, 1975. Six AC-130s and 52's air crew members were lost during the war. AC-130s destroyed more than 10,000 trucks and participated in many crucial close air support missions in Vietnam. With the conclusion of hostilities in Southeast Asia in the mid-1970s, the AC-130H became the sole gunship in the regular Air Force, home-based at Hurlburt Field, Florida, while the AC-130A fleet was transferred to the Air Force Reserve's 919th Tactical Airlift Group, 919 TAG, at Eglin AFB Auxiliary Field No. 3/Duke Field, Florida. With the transition to the AC-130A, the 919 TAG was then redesignated as the 919th Special Operations Group, 919 SOG. In the late 1970s, when the AC-130H fleet was first being modified for in-flight refueling capability, a demonstration mission was planned and flown from Hurlburt Field, Florida, non-stop, to conduct a two-hour live fire mission over Empire Firing Range in the Republic of Panama, then return home. This 13-hour mission with two in-flight refuelings from KC-135 tankers proved the validity of flying long-range missions outside the contiguous United States to attack targets then return to home base without intermediate stops. AC-130s from both the 4th and 16th Special Operations Squadrons have been deployed in nearly every conflict the United States has been involved in, officially and unofficially, since the end of the Vietnam War. In July 1979, AC-130H crews deployed to Howard Air Force Base, Panama, as a precaution against possible hostile actions against American personnel during the Nicaraguan Revolution. New time aloft and non-stop distance records were subsequently set by a 16th SOS two-ship AC-130H formation flight that departed Hurlburt Field on November 13, 1979 and landed 15th of November at Anderson Air Force Base, Guam, a distance of 29 hours 43 minutes non-stop, refueling four times in flight. Refueling support for the Guam deployment was provided by KC-135 crews from the 305th Air Refueling Wing from Grissom AFB, Indiana. In November 1979, four AC-130H gunships flew nonstop from Hurlburt Field to Anderson AFB, Guam, because of the hostage situation at the embassy in Iran. At Guam, AC-130H crews developed communications out/lights-out refueling procedures for later employment by trial and error. This deployment with the 1SO/CCS Task Force Commander was directed from the office of the CJCS for fear that Iranian militants could begin executing American embassy personnel who had been taken hostage on 4 November. One early option considered AC-130H retaliatory punitive strikes deep within Iran. Later gunship flights exceeded the 1979 Hurlburt to Guam flight. Upon return in March 1980, the four planes soon found themselves in Egypt to support the ill-fated hostage rescue attempt. During Operation Urgent Fury in Grenada in 1983, AC-130 suppressed enemy air defense systems and attacked ground forces, enabling the assault of the Point Salines airfield via airdrop and airland of friendly forces. The AC-130 aircrew earned the Lieutenant General William H. Turner Award for the mission. The AC-130HS of the 16th Special Operations Squadron Unit maintained an ongoing rotation to Howard Ab, Panama, monitoring activities in El Salvador and other Central American points of interest, with rules of engagement eventually permitting attacks on FMLN targets. This commitment of maintainers and crews started in 1983 and lasted until 1990. The AC-130 is considered to have hastened the end of the Salvadoran Civil War in the 1980s. Crews flew undercover missions from Honduras and attacked guerrilla camps and concentrations. AC-130s also had a primary role during the United States invasion of Panama, named Operation Just Cause, in 1989, when they destroyed Panama Defense Force headquarters and numerous command and control facilities, and provided close air support for U.S. ground troops. Aircrews earned the Mackay Trophy for the most meritorious flight of the year, and the Turner Award. During the Gulf War of 1990-91, Operations Desert Shield and Desert Storm, Regular Air Force and Air Force Reserve AC-130s provided close air support and force protection, air-based defense, for ground forces, and battlefield interdiction. The primary interdiction targets were early warning/ground control intercept, EU/GCI, sites along the southern border of Iraq. At its standard altitude of 12,000 feet, the aircraft had a proven ability to engage moving ground targets. The first gunship to enter the Battle of Hafji helped stop a southbound Iraqi armored column on January 29, 1991. One day later, three more gunships provided further aid to Marines participating in the operation. The gunships attacked Iraqi positions and columns moving south to reinforce their positions north of the city. Despite the threat of surface-to-air missiles, SAMs, and increasing visibility during the early morning hours of January 31, 1991, one AC-130H, AF serial number 69-6567, callsign Spirit 03, opted to stay to continue to protect the Marines. A lone Iraqi with Estrella 2 manpad shot Spirit 03 down, and all 14 crew members died. The military has used AC-130 gunships during the humanitarian operations in Somalia, Operation Restore Hope and Operation United Shield, in 1992-93, Operation Uphold Democracy in Haiti in 1994. AC-130s took part in Operation Assured Response in Liberia in 1996 and in Operation Silver Wake in 1997, the evacuation of American noncombatants from Albania. AC-130s took part in the NATO missions in Bosnia and Herzegovina and Kosovo during the 1990s. The AC-130U gunship set a new record for the longest sustained flight by any C-130 on 22 and October 23, 1997, when two AC-130U gunships flew 36 hours nonstop from Hurlburt Field, Florida to Daegu Air Base, Daegu, South Korea, being refueled seven times in the air by KC-135 tankers. The two gunships took on 410,000 pounds, 186,000 kilograms, of fuel. Gunships also were part of the buildup of U.S. forces in 1998 to compel Iraq to allow UNSCOM weapons inspections. The U.S. has used gunships with deployments to the war in Afghanistan, Operation Enduring Freedom, Afghanistan 2001-2014, and Iraq War, Operation Iraqi Freedom, 2003-11. AC-130 strikes were directed by special forces on known Taliban locations during the early days of the war in Afghanistan. U.S. Special Operations Forces are using the AC-130 to support its operations. The day after arriving in Afghanistan, the AC-130s attacked Taliban and Al-Qaeda forces near the city of Qunduz and were directly responsible for the city's surrender the next day. On November 26, 2001, Spectres were called in to put down a rebellion at the prison fort of Ala-i-Jangi. The 16 SOS flew missions over Mazar-i-Sharif, Qunduz, Kandahar, Shkin, Asadabad, Bagram, Bagran, Tora Bora, and virtually every other part of Afghanistan. The Spectre participated in countless operations within Afghanistan, performing on-call close air support and armed reconnaissance. In March 2002, three AC-130 Spectres provided 39 crucial combat missions in support of Operation Anaconda in Afghanistan. During the intense fighting, the planes fired more than 1,340 mm in 1,200 plus 105 mm rounds. Close air support was the main mission of the AC-130 in Iraq. Night after night, at least one AC-130 was in the air to fulfill one or more air support requests, ASRS. A typical mission had the AC-130 supporting a single brigade's ASRs followed by aerial refueling in another 2 hours with another brigade or soft team. The use of AC-130s in places like Fallujah, urban settings where insurgents were among crowded populations of non-combatants, was criticized by human rights groups. AC-130s were also used for intelligence gathering with their sophisticated long-range video, infrared and radar sensors. In 2007, U.S. Special Operations Forces also used the AC-130-inch's attacks on suspected Al-Qaeda militants in Somalia. There were 8 AC-130H and 17 AC-130U aircraft in active duty service as of July 2010. In March 2011, the U.S. Air Force deployed 2 AC-130U gunships to take part in Operation Odyssey Dawn, the U.S. military intervention in Libya, which eventually came under NATO as Operation Unified Protector. By September 2013, 14 MC-130W Dragon Spear aircraft have been converted to AC-130W Stinger II gunships. The Stinger gunships have been deployed to Afghanistan to replace the aging AC-130H aircraft and provide an example for the new AC-130J Ghost Rider. Modifications began with crews cutting holes in the plane to make room for weapons, and adding kits and bomb bases for laser-guided munitions. Crews added a 105 mm cannon, 20-inch infrared and electro-optical sensors, and the ability to carry 250-pound bombs in the wings. On November 15, 2015, 2 days after the attacks in Paris by ISIL, AC-130s and A-10 Thunderbolt II attack aircraft destroyed a convoy of over 100 ISIL-operated oil tanker trucks in Syria. The attacks were part of an intensification of the U.S.-led military intervention against ISIL called Operation Tidal Wave II, named after the original Operation Tidal Wave during World War II, a failed attempt to raid German oil fields that resulted in heavy aircraft and aircrew loss, in an attempt to cut off oil smuggling as a source of funding for the group. On October 3, 2015, an AC-130 mistakenly attacked the Doctors Without Borders Hospital in Qunduz, Afghanistan. In 5 separate runs, the gunship struck the hospital that was erroneously identified as the source of attacks on Coalition members. Subsequent inquiries led to punishment of 16 military personnel and cited human error as the root cause. On September 30, 2017, the Air Force declared the AC-130J Ghost Rider had achieved initial operational capability, IOC, with 6 gunships having been delivered. The aircraft is planned to reach full operational capability by 2023 with a total of 37 gunships delivered. The J variant is lighter and more fuel efficient than previous versions, able to fly it with a range of and service ceiling of United States Air Force. One of the first 7 AC-130A aircraft deployed to Vietnam was AF serial number 53-3129, named First Lady in November 1970. This aircraft was a conversion of the first production Ku-130. On March 25, 1971, it took an anti-aircraft artillery hit in the belly just aft of the nose gear wheel well over the Ho Chi Minh Trail in Laos. The 37mm shell destroyed everything below the crew deck and barely missed striking two crew members. The pilot was able to crash land the aircraft safely. In 1975, after the conclusion of U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War, it was transferred to the Air Force Reserve, where it served with the 711th Special Operations Squadron off 919th Special Operations Wing. In 1980, the aircraft was upgraded from the original three-bladed propellers to the quieter four-bladed propellers and was eventually retired in late 1995. The retirement also marked an end to the Air Force Reserve Command flying the AC-130A. The aircraft now sits on display in the final Air Force Reserve Command configuration with gray paint, black markings, and the four-bladed Hamilton Sunstrand 54H6091 props at the Air Force Armament Museum at Eglin Air Force Base, Florida, USA. A second aircraft, AF serial number 56-0509, named the Ultimate End, was originally accepted as an C-130A by the Air Force on February 28, 1957, and modified to the AC-130A configuration July 27, 1970. The aircraft participated in the Vietnam War in the rescue of the SS Mayaguez. Ultimate End demonstrated the durability of the C-130 after surviving hits in five places by 37mm anti-aircraft artillery on December 12, 1970, extensive left-wing leading-edge damage on April 12, 1971 and a 57mm round damaging the belly and injuring one crewman on March 4, 1972. Ultimate End was reassigned to the Air Force Reserve's 919th Special Operations Wing at Eglin AFB Auxiliary Field No. 3, Duke Field on June 17, 1975, where it continued in service until retired in the fall 1994 and transferred to Air Force Special Operations Command's Heritage Air Park at Hurlburt Field, Florida. While assigned to the 711th Special Operations Squadron, Ultimate End served in Operations Just Cause in Panama, Desert Storm in Kuwait and Iraq, and Uphold Democracy in Haiti. After 36 years and 7 months of service, 24 years as a gunship, Ultimate End retired from active service on October 1, 1994. It made its last flight from Duke Field to Hurlburt Field on October 20, 1994. The Spectre Association dedicated Ultimate End, which served with the 16 SOS in Vietnam, on 4 May 1995. Lieutenant Colonel Michael Byers, then 16 SOS commander, represented the active duty gunship force, and Clyde Gowdy of the Spectre Association represented all Spectre personnel past and present for the unveiling of a monument at the aircraft and the dedication as a whole. A third AC-130A, AF serial number 54-1630, is on display in the Cold War Gallery at the National Museum of the United States Air Force at Wright-Patterson AFB, Ohio. Named Azrael for the Angel of Death in Islam who severs the soul from the body, this aircraft figured prominently in the closing hours of Operation Desert Storm. On February 26, 1991, coalition ground forces were driving the Iraqi army out of Kuwait. With an Air Force Reserve crew called to active duty, Azrael was sent to the Al Jarrah Highway, Highway 80, between Kuwait City and Basra, Iraq, to intercept the convoys of tanks, trucks, buses, and cars fleeing the battle. Facing SA-6 and SA-8 surface-to-air missiles and 37mm and 57mm radar-guided anti-aircraft artillery, the crew attacked and destroyed or disabled most of the convoys. Azrael was also assigned to the 919th Special Operations Wing and retired to the museum in October 1995. Another AC-130A, AF serial number 54-1626. The original prototype AC-130 named Gunship 2 is on display at the Outdoor Air Park at the National Museum of the United States Air Force at Wright-Patterson AFB, Ohio. This aircraft served in Southeast Asia from 1967 to 1972, then served in JC-130A test configuration. It was transferred to the National Museum of the United States Air Force in 1976, and converted back to AC-130A configuration in the late 1990s. AC-130A serial number 54-1623, CN-3010, named Ghost Rider, served in Southeast Asia and later conflicts until being retired in 1997 to Dobbins AFB, Georgia. Ghost Rider eventually was transferred and displayed at the Aviation Wing Museum at Marietta, Georgia. Prior to circa 2000 latest armament. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.